Thank you, students. Hey, good morning, everybody. My name is Michael Cummings. I'm a student ministry pastor here, and I want to start with a warning. Here's the deal. I'm high energy, and I'm struggling up here because they put this little square on the floor, and I've got to stay inside of it. I feel like a caged lion, so my nervous energy walking back and forth, I'm just warning you ahead of time. We've been in this series, Up, In, and Out, and we've been looking at Jesus' three great loves, his love with the Father to be up, his in with the relationships of the people you're supposed to be surrounded with, and then out, going into a broken world and sharing the gospel. And I'm excited about this week because I get to start off by telling you the story about somebody I love to talk about, which is myself. And I'm going to share with you how I became the student ministry pastor at Colonial Church, because it's a crazy story how I ended up here. I was 7 years ago, I was the athletic director for the Boys and Girls Clubs of Wichita Falls. I love that job. Here's the deal. My responsibilities were to set up all the sports programs for the community of Wichita Falls ran through the Boys and Girls Club. So I was in charge of football and cheerleading, indoor soccer, basketball, and volleyball. And I thought, like, this is the greatest job. I got to do the two things I love so much. The first thing was I got to be around sports. I believe sports is one of the most important things for younger people. I believe that it teaches discipline. It teaches them how to work as a team. So I love sports. The second thing was I got to talk into young people's lives. I got to speak into the young kids and to be a part of their life day in and day out. When I was down at the athletic department, which is located at Central Boys and Girls Club, what I would do is I would go to work early, try to get all my paperwork done because paperwork's what I had to actually accomplish. And then as soon as I was done, when the kids came in at 3 o'clock from all their schools, I would go in the gym and I would play sports with them. We'd play basketball and indoor soccer, and there's just so many games that I got to play with kids. And I love that. And here's the deal is I have relationships still with several of those kids to this day. Some of them are graduating. Some of them have graduated from high school. But I had the opportunity to spend time with these young people. Well, 5 years ago, a little over 5 years ago, here at Colonial Church, everybody that was in student ministry stepped down from Colonial Church. As a matter of fact, we lost all our youth pastors in a matter of 1 to 2 weekends. All of them found other jobs. All of them had other things they were going to do. And it was right before Colonial Student Weekend. Now, Colonial Student Weekend is this huge thing that we do here at Colonial Church for the students. And what we do is we find host homes for the students to go to. They break down by age groups, and they go hang out in host homes for 72 hours. They get to spend time with their small group leaders. It's one of the best things that we get to do with these students because it gives us an opportunity to learn what's going on in their lives, meet their families, hang out with them. We also have 3 sessions that we get to come in here, do worship, and we talk about things that are going on in their lives. Well, we were going to have to cancel Colonial Student Weekend because we had nobody to run Colonial Student Weekend. And for me, as a small group leader, this is something that I looked forward to each and every year. It was a chance for me to hang out with my boys and talk about what's going on in life. So I decided, okay, I'm not going to let this fail. The kids have already lost their student ministry pastors at the time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go work at the Boys and Girls Club all day. And then in the after I get off, I'm going to come to church and I'm going to make sure I get all the logistical part of Colonial Student Weekend going. I wanted to make sure for the students that we could to continue this tradition that we had. So I thank the youth pastors that were here before because they actually already had the speaker and the band lined up. All I had to do was find the host homes and get the kids signed up for the weekend. That year, our first year, I think Colonial Student Weekend was a success because luckily no kids got hurt. So it was a huge success for us because nobody got injured. But after Colonial Student Weekend, we still had a problem. The problem was we still didn't have anybody to guide that ministry, to lead that ministry that was on staff. So I told the staff that was here, I said, hey, I'll continue to volunteer, work at the Boys and Girls Club, and then at the end of the day, I'll come back over to Colonial Church. I'll make sure that we have the slides that you see. I'll make sure I bring a message. I'll make sure that the lights are kind of set up. We did worship at the time, but we were singing the tracks for the students that remember that. So really, I would just push play on the songs, and we would sing along to it. But I was ensuring that everything was going, so we continued a student ministry program here at Colonial Church. A month into it, the executive pastor that was here at the time said, hey, Big Mike, let's go to lunch. I love lunch, and I love free food. So when he invited me to lunch, I'm like, okay, I'll go sit down with you. While we were at lunch, he asked me, he said, have you ever thought about being on a church staff? Guys, I tell you, I never would have imagined this. And it was hard for me because I'm sitting there thinking, I love the Boys and Girls Club. I get to do everything in life I always have dreamed of doing, be with kids and be in sports. Well, after praying and fasting, me and my wife decided maybe God is calling us to be at Colonial Church. So I stepped down. I put in my 2-week notice at Colonial or at the Boys and Girls Club, and I came on full-time here on staff. And I'm going to be honest with you. For the first 2 years, I did not know how to do student ministry. As a matter of fact, what I would do is I would read books and how to build a student ministry. I would listen to podcasts. I would go talk to other student ministry programs. Because in my head, what was a healthy and a good student ministry program was actually the number of kids I had coming to the program and the number of adult leaders I had. That's what I was stressing about. So what I would do is I would try to do anything I could to learn how to grow the student ministry program. For the first 2 years, Colonial students, for the ones that have been here a long time, will tell you it was like this Frankenstein thing that I had built. And what it was is I would take bits and pieces from different things, and I would try to implement them in our student ministry program. So every 3 weeks, there's something new we were doing. We were trying the new fad. We were trying to do showy things to invite students to church. 2 years into it, I'm sitting there, and I sit back, and I go, man, student ministry is not anything I wanted. If I look back from now, I go, man, student ministry is a big failure here at Colonial Church. Like, I was not doing what I wanted. And I missed the whole point. I can tell you, 3 years ago, I changed completely. And here's what it was. I was trying to do God's work each and every day without inviting God to be a part of it. I was trying to teach the students about Jesus Christ, but I didn't invite Jesus into what was going on. I just tried to do everything on what I wanted. And as adults, I believe for a lot of us, we actually do the same thing. We try to do life, we try to do things, but we don't invite Jesus to be a part of it. We don't invite God into our situations. And then when we look around, we go, where is God at? Why is God not helping me through this? You know, we're in this series, Up, In, and Out, and I think today we look at Jesus Christ as the example. What does it mean to be up with the Father? We're going to look in the book of Hebrews. We're going to start in Hebrews, and I always tell everybody we need to understand the context. So if you want to open your Bibles now to the book of Hebrews, if you don't have one, we have some in the back. You can also turn on your YouVersion Bible app, go to live events, and my notes will be there, all the verses I'll be covering, so you can take notes in that and follow along. But we got to understand what the book of Hebrews was written for. This letter was written for Jewish Christians. It's a group of people that grew up in Jewish faith, Jewish traditions, but became Christ followers. So their lives have been changed. Their whole traditions have been changed because Jesus Christ changed that for each and every one of us. But what is happening now is the Jewish people are starting to resort back to the old law, the old tradition, and they're missing the whole point of what Jesus Christ did for us. And this letter is supposed to remind us, okay, what does it mean now that it's different, that we're Christ followers? And in this section, he's talking about prayer. And he's talking about what does it mean for our prayer life. So in chapter 5, verse 7, where we're going to look at what it means for us to our prayer life should be. It says, while Jesus was here on earth, he offered prayers and pleadings with a loud cry and tears to the one who could rescue him from death. And God heard his prayers because of his deep reverence for God. Even though Jesus was God's son, he learned obedience from the things he suffered. In this way, God qualified him as the perfect high priest, and he became the source of eternal salvation for all those who obey him. This section has some language that we don't use often here at Colonial Church. We have a pastor, Lauren, that we talk about, but it says high priest in there. And for us, when we hear that word high priest, it's kind of confusing because we don't use that language. But we got to understand the context of who this letter is written for. It's written to the Hebrew or to Jewish people that have changed to be Christ followers. And for them, they understood what high priest meant. For them, they knew that they, for a long time, had to go to somebody. And they had to confess their sins. They had to give their prayers up. They had to let them know what's going on in their life to a priest. And then what was happening is the priest would go to God for them. He was the go-between. He would bring up whatever was going on in their lives. And then when he was done, he would come back to him and he'd go, okay, this is what God said to me. And then he would tell them what they need to do to reconcile their sins, whatever they needed to do. Well, with Jesus, it changes the whole thing. Now he is the example, but we no longer have to go through somebody to get to the Father. Instead, it's changed everything that we do because of Jesus Christ. Now we have direct access to the Father. So when we're looking at our prayer life, we understand that we no longer have to go between somebody. We actually have the ability to go to the Father directly for ourselves. So if with us understanding that Jesus is the high priest, he's the example we need to follow, what does his example look like in our prayer life? What does it look like for us to go to the Father? And I think the best thing for us to do is to start at the back of Luke and work our way to the front and look at three examples of what Jesus Christ's prayer life looked like. Luke writes down and lets us know what he did to pray each and every day to the Father. So starting in chapter 22, we're going to look at one of these examples of what Jesus Christ's prayer life looked like. little context in this chapter before we get started. Jesus had just now finished the Last Supper. He was with the disciples upstairs. He just now said, my time is coming. He just now told Peter, hey, you will deny me three times. He's given them the whole, like, okay, this is the situation, guys. Here's what we're about to go through. And the time starts now. And right after that, Jesus goes to where he has his place that he goes. He has this rhythm of how he speaks to the Father. And we're going to look at how he speaks to the Father at this time. So starting in verse 39, it says, then accompanied by the disciples, Jesus left the upstairs room and went as usual to pray to the Mount of Olives. There he told them, pray that you will not give in to temptation. He walked about a stone's throw away and knelt down and prayed. Father, if you are willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will be done, not mine. Then an angel from heaven appeared and strengthened him. He prayed more fervently and was in such agony of the spirit that his sweat fell to the ground like great drops of blood. See, Jesus knew that he was fixing to take on the sins of the world, things that he hadn't done. He was fixing to take that on, and he was struggling with it. It was hard for him. He was sitting there thinking, God, this is hard for me. I need you to guide me. You know, we do the same thing in our lives. We hit hard times, whatever that hard times might be. When we hit hard times, we start praying, God, please, where are you at right now? God, hey, I need your help through this. Lord, I want you to guide me in this situation. But here's where we mess up. We pray and we ask for what we want. So when we have a hard situation, we start praying and going, hey, God, I want you to solve it this way. The best way for me to end this financial difficulty is you do A, B, C, or D. We start praying to God like he's a genie God, that he's going to solve the situation exactly how we want it. But in these verses, we see that Jesus does something. He flips the script and says, no, that's not how we're supposed to pray. Verse 42 again, it says, Father, if you're willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will be done, not mine. Guys, some of the times people sit there and look at what happens in their life situations and they automatically say, God didn't help me through that situation. God wasn't there with me. But God actually answered your prayers. It's just you didn't get the answer you wanted. You didn't get the final answer that you were expecting. I know I've done this in my life. That you go through a hard time and you sit there and you look for an answer and you get an answer, but it's not the one that you expected. So if we're going to look at Jesus Christ as the example of what it means to go to the Father in times of need, we need to understand that sometimes our prayers don't get answered the way we think it should be done. And God's will, sometimes it's hard for us to understand. Hard for us to go, okay, I don't understand why it ended up this way, but God, I've got to trust that this is your plan. Jesus shows us, hey, I've got to trust that this is what you've got for me. I've got to trust that your plan is more important. So I think we all need to understand that sometimes our prayers don't get answered the way we expect, but we go to the Father in hard times. In chapter 10, we look at another time that Jesus goes directly to the Father. We're going to read all about the times that he's up orientated and he's going to the Father. In chapter 10, verse 21, it says, at the same time, Jesus was filled with the joy of the Holy Spirit. And he said, oh, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, thank you for hiding these things from those who think themselves wise and clever and for revealing them to the childlike. Yes, Father, it pleased you to do it this way. This chapter, Jesus is so excited about what's going on that he just automatically goes to the Father. He's so thankful. He's like, Jesus, or Father, I see what you're doing, and I'm so excited. And he tells him, I see your plan. You didn't reveal it to everybody. You revealed it to the childlike. And he automatically goes right to the Father, and he's excited. But I want us to look before that. What is he so excited about? What is he so excited to go directly to the Father for? And Lauren started in this chapter last week. When we started talking about the out last week, it's the section that he sends out the 72. And he sends out the 72, and what he wanted them to do is go share the message of who Christ is. He wanted them to heal. He wanted them to cast out demons. And starting in verse 17, we look at what happened when the 72 returned back to Jesus. When the 72 disciples returned, they joyfully reported to him, Lord, even the demons obey us when we use your name. Yes, he told them, I saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning. Look, I have given you authority over all power of the enemy, and you can walk among snakes and scorpions and crush them. Nothing will injure you. But don't rejoice because evil spirits obey you. Rejoice because your names are registered in heaven. Jesus got this word back from the 72 that have been out sharing the gospel and spreading the message and healing and casting out demons. And they come back and Jesus is just so excited because he saw the Father at work constantly. And the 72 got their eyes open to see God at work in everything they were doing. And you know, for us, I say something to the students all the time. I tell the students, I say, listen, if you have your eyes open and your heart open, you can see God at work each and every day. You know, we live in a society a lot of times that say, hey, we don't see miracles anymore. We don't see God at work. We don't get to see what we talk about in the Bible, but I disagree with that. I agree that if we start our day with our hearts open, our minds open, and say, God, I want to see what you have for me, then we will see God at work. I believe that there's miracles every day. But we just got to have our hearts open, our minds open to see it. So Jesus right here is so thankful in the fact that he's like, God, I see you working. I know you're doing what you do. And I think for us, that's where we need to be. We need to start our day, Lord, thank you for what you've done. For me, as I get older, I'm just thank you for another day. Thank you for me waking up today. But I sit there and think about this as they're talking about it. If we have our eyes open, our hearts open like Jesus did, we get to see the fact that demons are cast out, that people, evil spirits are gone, that people are healed. We get to see people come to Christ, and that's what we're like. What gets us going each and every day. So I believe if we're going to use Jesus as an example, one, we got to go to him during hard times. We also got to be thankful for the things that we see in our lives. And then the last time is in chapter 6. So if you flip over to chapter 6, Jesus has to make a decision. Jesus has to make a decision, and we sit there and think about our lives. When we make a decision, do we invite God into that situation? Do we ask God what the answer is? Chapter 6, starting in verse 12, it says, one day soon afterward, Jesus went up on a mountain to pray, and he prayed to God all night. At daybreak, he called together all his disciples and chose 12 of them to be apostles. Here are their names. Simon, who he named Peter, Andrew, Peter's brother, James, John, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, who was called the Zealot, Judas, son of James, Judas Iscariot, who later betrayed him. I'm one of those people that's a visual learner. I have to see things. You know, I can read something over and over again until I can sit there and stop and take a minute to visualize it, or somebody shows me a picture, or I watch something. I don't really comprehend everything that it's saying. And this section is one of those times that I had to use my imagination, because for us to think about praying all night, that's something that's hard for us to go, man, you know, a five-minute prayer, I'm done. And I've maxed out. But it says Jesus prayed all night here. And I have to imagine Jesus sitting there and thinking of all the people that he has to make a decision. Who is going to be his in? So Jesus is sitting there thinking, and I believe in my head that he's naming off each one. He's sitting there going, Father, is Simon the one? Is Simon Peter the guy that I'm supposed to be doing life with? Is he the guy that I'm supposed to surround my life with? Is John the one? You know, John's one of them, and he's been with me a long time. Is John the one that you want me in my inner circle? And then he gets to the hard part. He goes, is Judas the one? Do I need this guy with me, knowing that his final destination is that he's going to sell me out? Do I need Judas with me? Are these the 12 that I'm supposed to surround myself with? For our lives, we get to forks in the road, and we've got to make decisions. We've got to decide, am I going this way or that way? And a lot of times, we choose for the path that we like the most, which one looks the prettiest and shiniest to it. But we see Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus goes, who am I going to surround myself with? Lord, who are you putting around me? Lord, I want you to be a part of everything that I'm doing here, so please show me a direction. I think it's important for us to understand that when we make life decisions, if we invite God into that situation, we're going to be able to see what God has for each and every one of us. So I told you that through this series, we've been looking at what it means to be up, and we've talked about making sure that we're with Jesus when we're with the Father when we're praying through hard times, when we're thankful for things, and also when we're having to make life decisions. And I love talking about myself, but there's somebody I like to talk about even more than myself, and that's my Terry, my princess. We've been married 23 years. I love that picture right there because the guitarist right here was actually at his wedding. I got to officiate his wedding, so I was excited to be a part of that. But when I talk about our life and when I talk about our time frame together, these 23 years, we can separate it into two time frames. We can say our before Christ time, and we can talk about our after Christ time. And for our family, for the first half of that, the before Christ time was a hard time. I was in the military for 10 years. I got out in 2003. We came out of the military, and we went through struggles. Financially, we had problems. We never both had a job. We had so many other issues. Like when we went to hard times, we struggled to get through hard times. We couldn't get through them. I told y'all at the beginning that sports is a huge thing to me, and I believe sports also made a change in my life. I was a coach of a team called the Leathernecks. That's how I got invested in the boys' club and got started. And I coached the Leathernecks for 10 years. And during that 10-year time frame of coaching the Leathernecks, I gave up alcohol. I decided alcohol is not near as important as my family, so I gave up drinking. And I also got invited by a family of one of the kids I was coaching invited us to church. And my wife pushed me. She was the spiritual leader at the time of our family. She was pushing me, and she goes, hey, we really should get involved somewhere. We really should go check out church. Our lives are a little bit different now. We're getting older. We have a child. Let's go check out church. I got to come to Colonial Church. I'm going to be honest with you. I love Colonial Church and the fact that I got to come in with a cup of coffee and I'd hide at the back of the room and nobody knew who I was. I could come in and sneak in and out and nobody knew who I was. I love worship. I love the fact of, like, that was what I got to do. Well, about 2 months after being at Colonial Church, there was a message that was given. And during the message, Terry and I were convicted. We're like, okay, we need to get involved in church somehow. We need to get connected. So Terry signed up to work downstairs. She loves babies. She would let her hold babies every day of the week. That's not my cup of tea. As y'all know, I'm with student ministry. So I got connected with the student ministry program. I became a small group leader. And from that time on, we have been connected to Colonial Church. As a matter of fact, our entire family accepted Christ in this building. We can tell you our lives have been changed. I want you to understand, though, like the last series, it hasn't been rainbows and butterflies. We still argue on the way to church. We still have issues that we have to work through. We still have struggles. But here's the deal is, as Christ followers, understanding this up in and out, we understand that life is so much different. When we go through hard times, we know that God's will is the plan at the end of the day. We trust in what God has. And when we're going through struggles, we go directly to the Father because that's what we're called to do. So I want to challenge everybody in the room. I'm going to start with the men in the room right off the bat. Men, I told you at the beginning, and if you listened just a second ago, I was not the spiritual leader of our family, which we're called as Christ followers to be the spiritual leaders of our family. So for that, I ask that we start being the ones that show what it means to have an up relationship. We set the example for our families to show what it means to be up with the Father day in and day out. And we set the example for our families. I failed at that, and now I am that spiritual leader because I understand the importance of it. For everybody in the room, I want you to try to find that rhythm. What is that rhythm that you need to be up with the Father? What is the rhythm that you need to spend more time opening your lives and having the minds and hearts open to see what God has? I had to work on finding my rhythm. My rhythm was one of those things that, you know, when you work in church, sometimes you lose a rhythm. You completely miss being the prayer time and being in the Bible and the Word. And so 2 years ago, I went on a mission. I decided that I've got to lose weight. I don't know if y'all know this, but I was 100 pounds heavier, and I decided I needed to lose weight because students are getting younger, and students are getting faster, I'm getting older. And I was like, I felt like I couldn't keep up with them. We get out there and play football, and I was sucking for air. So I had to make some changes in my life. The first thing I changed is I had to start eating healthy, which wasn't fun, but I started eating healthier meals and making sure I pay attention to what my intake is. But then I also had to change my cardio habits. And so what I did is I started walking or running 3 to 4 miles every morning. And I said, okay, if I'm going to change my habits, what are some other habits, some things I need to change? Well, I decided that I'm no longer going to wear headphones when I go running. I'm just going to be like with nature. I'm just going to go out there. And then I decided, hey, I have approximately an hour that I get to spend with God. So during my run time, my rhythm is that I automatically, as soon as I take off running, I'm like, okay, this is my prayer time. This is my time to be up with the Father. The first 2 miles are usually, God, please don't let me die on this run. I'm sucking for air and I can't breathe. But the second 2 miles are always great because now I'm just in conversation. I've caught my rhythm. I'm breathing. I'm thinking, God, what do you have for me? God, what is your plan in my life? What is the next step I'm supposed to do? I think finding that rhythm for each and every one of us is what we need to do. What does the rhythm of our life look like to be up with the Father? You know, last week when we talk about rhythms, last week Lauren started a new rhythm. And that rhythm was, if we're going to pray out for an organization or a church in the community. And I love that. I love the fact that last week we opened up, we prayed for Young Life and who they're reaching and what they do every Monday at 7:29. If y'all don't know the time, it's on the back of every student's car. But I look at what Young Life was doing, and I was excited about that. And I get the opportunity to pray for an organization I care so much about, which is the Boys and Girls Club. Like I said, I was a volunteer coach for 10 years. I worked at the Boys and Girls Club. And the Boys and Girls Club is one of the best programs, nonprofit organizations I've ever been a part of. Because one, they provide a safe place for kids for $16 a year. So they could go to the Boys and Girls Club every day for $16 a year and be a part of something so much bigger. And they get opportunities to go to camp. They get opportunities to play sports. There's so much that you can do with the Boys and Girls Club. The second thing is the people that work there work tirelessly for these young kids. You know, I said it's a nonprofit organization. They're not the highest paid people on earth, but they work day in and day out to make sure they have good programs for the kids, to make sure that they're teaching kids life lessons, starting from age 6 all the way up to the age of 18. And so as we get ready to go up to the Father, I want us to make sure that we're going out and pray for the Boys and Girls Club today. So let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this opportunity. I thank you so much for us just looking at what it means to be with you, what it means to invite you into our lives, what it means to have you when we're going through hard times and struggles, and just thankful for what you do in our lives. Lord, I pray for the men in the room right now. I pray that they become the spiritual leaders if they're not now. They work on that because we're called to do so much more. And I pray even for myself that I continue to be the spiritual leader for my family. Lord, I pray for everybody that we find that rhythm. We find that rhythm of what we're called to do to have a relationship with you and to look up and trust you in everything. Lord, I pray for the Boys and Girls Club right now. What an awesome organization that just cares and loves on so many kids in this community that they just work tireless hours, day in and day out, and just always come in with a smile and excited to see kids, Lord. So I pray for that organization. Lord, I pray for our week. I pray that we go from here and we share the gospel. We get that out orientation and tell people who you are. And if anything, just show who you are by our actions, how we act. Lord, we just are excited for another day. We love you and we thank you. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.